Lecture series. It's a Friday evening, and it's so cold, and I salute you for making the effort to come here. Your presence over here is very important to us. We are a very young organization. We started only about 2 years ago. We have been holding the Friday lecture series because we think that professionals, academics, and experts outside can talk about issues that are of concern to the Asian and Asian American community. And we do a lot of things. Usually we don't have this, but this is the Chinese New Year is coming up, and some of us thought that it's a good idea to put this to greet everybody and, you know, wish you all a very, very happy New Year.
Thank you.
The Asian American and Asian Research Institute holds many different kind of events. Besides the nearly weekly Friday lecture series, we also have conferences. And we are going to have a conference on South Asian community within this, the United States. It will take place at Baruch College on March 19th. And then there is a conference on Asian American students within the City University of New York. That will take place on April 30th. It's a Friday. It will take place at the Graduate Center. Then there is on May 14th, there will be a CUNY Asian American Film and Media Festival. It will also take place at the Graduate Center. I mention all of that just to let you know that we do a lot of different activities, and we welcome your participation. You're not going to remember all of those things that I said. But you should remember one thing, and that is our website address, which is www.aaaricuny.info. And on that website, you will be able to find all the information. aaaricuny.info. And you'll find all the information. And we really try to build up such a website so that
really faculty terrific.
Members, students from throughout CUNY can participate,
snowflakes.
And also people from outside of CUNY can participate and share information about the Asian communities in the United States. As you know, the growth of Asian population in the city is quite a tremendous one. And for the Chinese Americans also, it's, the growth is phenomenal. And it is very fortunate that we have with us tonight somebody who is very knowledgeable about immigrants, the Chinese immigrants, the students who have to adjust to the new life culture in the city and also in the schools. And so, I'm very happy to introduce to you the speaker for tonight, Professor Virginia Tong, who is from education at Hunter College, and she teaches in the Masters in Arts program in TSSOL. I don't know what that stands for.
ESL, Teaching English as a Second Language.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And her research interests are acculturation, computer-assisted language learning and literacy, and teacher education. And tonight she's going to talk to us about the acculturation of Chinese immigrant students within the school. Please welcome Professor Tong.
Hi, thank you, Dr. Tan. How are you this evening? Hope you're warm. Hope you're getting warm, right?
Very warm in here.
Isn't it wonderful? I know. I'll put my little friend next to me here. Well, thank you very much for being here. I can't tell you what a thrill it is for me to be here to share my research. Let me be one of the first to wish you a Happy New Year for the past January 1st and for the upcoming Chinese New Year. So on both sides, Happy New Year, double time. Tonight's talk is a very, very dear topic to me. I grew up in Chinatown and watched many of the students in the school system down there, and I often wondered what was going on in their heads and in the school. And then when I had the opportunity to actually conduct some research, I did so especially with that population in mind. I was especially interested in looking at the impact of the school as an institution on the acculturation of these students. I chose high school because much of the time research is done on younger children and not on high school students. And I feel that high school students are sometimes left out of the picture, left out of the equation, because they're seen as being responsible, they take care of their younger siblings, and they often work. Many of the Chinese kids work. I actually taught in Chinatown. I taught at Lower East Side Prep High School, so I really know the population well. They're a great bunch of kids. They're so terrific. If only someone would give them a voice, listen to their words and the cries for outreach behind their words. So I'm going to talk to you about an acculturation model that I've created within the school environment. It's part of this is the second part to a two-part study. I conducted a study in 1994 where I looked at acculturation in the home environment. This is a school environment. So with the two, I hope to create a fuller picture, a fuller understanding as to what the acculturation process is all about for these kids, high school kids who've been here 1 to 3 years, and kids who are struggling within themselves and without themselves, beyond them, with people outside of their own mental thinking. So I put together some ideas for you, and I hope you'll enjoy them. So that's by way of an introduction to my talk. Will we have the light on?
No,
I'll have to take. Okay, alrighty, great. I also chose to look at acculturation within the school because acculturation is usually thought about in terms of social aspects, or the sociocultural aspects of our existence. And to get a real picture of what goes on with these kids, you have to look at what are their experiences while they're in school, while they're adjusting. And so I chose school life as the venue to talk about acculturation. Click. I have Anthony, who's helping me. He's been absolutely wonderful, and Dr. Tam has been one of my mentors. I want to give recognition to a very dear professor of mine, Professor Sally Milgram, who is from Hunter College. Thank you for coming, Sally. Yeah, she's been my mentor, and she always says when she goes around Hunter, this was a student of mine, this was a student of mine, and indeed I was, and so proud to have been. I think these kids, as quiet as they are, as reticent as they are, they don't have a voice. And that's almost ironic, that they don't have a voice out there, a collective voice, to express what they feel. This is one of two quotes. This first quote is taken from Ben, an actual person that I collected data from this past spring. This study that you will see now actually took place during the spring of 2003, I went to a high school and collected data. And Ben is one of two students, and Tricia is the second student that you'll see in just a moment. Ben he speaks English so well, and from outward appearances, it looks like he's very well adjusted. But really, when we sat down during the interview process, I thought this quote really captured the essence of what he felt. I have to give up some of being Chinese. What does that mean, giving up some of what he always believed in, his values? He's from Hong Kong and grew up in Hong Kong and has been here maybe 2 years. But he feels he has to give up something of being Chinese. I suppose that does happen when students acculturate. But then the question is, do they really acculturate or do they adapt? That's the question I put out to you. Can we? Tricia, interestingly, makes an observation about the school, about teachers in the school. And here she says, teachers give us wrong grades because they don't understand us, they don't know us by our Chinese names. Now, if you think about your Chinese name, how important a Chinese name is. For you to cross over and take an American name or an English name, while it's appropriate because you want to bond with the American culture, this is a different reason for doing it. That teachers don't see the difference in pronunciation, and I can understand that, but they don't make an effort, it seems, according to this group of students that I spoke with. That in that school, they gloss over the names and don't really give the individual attention to the names that they should. So I thought this captured the essence of the school environment. That's Ben up there, his very personal interpretation, and then Tricia from the school. So I wanted to offer these two quotes as a way to set the context for the study. The study itself. The focus of the study was to examine the values, attitudes, and behaviors underlying their school life. I looked at levels of participation in activities and the kinds of interactions that students have with teachers and other students. The main purpose of this study was to develop an acculturation model within the school context so that I could couple it with my previous study. And here, I feel that once we begin to chisel away at this acculturation process and look at what happens internally in the student, I think we can get a fuller picture so that eventually, within the school environment, we can develop programs, develop policies that are very appropriate to their very special needs. Now, while Tricia said that teachers didn't know the names, well, it may be difficult for people who don't speak Chinese to recognize the names. But there's even more of a need for those teachers who are very sincere to look at the names so that a fuller understanding can be gotten about the names. The names mean something. What do the names mean? You can even get into different levels of understanding there. But that's a point for another time. Hello, come on in. Please come in, make yourselves comfortable. There's supposed to be sound. I guess there's no sound.
What the sound?
I don't know. The sound worked on mine before. Oh, you don't have speakers. Oh, okay. No, it's okay. No. The words are really more important, right? Okay. So to reiterate, to summarize the focus of my talk, the research question I think summarizes it. What are the school influences that support or hinder acculturation, as I measured it by student participation and interactions within the school? Okay, so the sample, this for me, it was an exploratory pilot study to see if there was anything to my theory that acculturation really does take place within the school environment and to describe or to look at the dimensions of that acculturation experience for kids, these kids. The population the sample that I used were high school students. There were 54. They aged in range. I've given you averages here, the mean point. Most of them were 16 to 17 years old. This is 45% of the population. There were some who were much younger and some who were older, but the mean age was 16 to 17. Their grades were 9th and 10th grade. And you could see there even these students are a little bit older. They're not in parallel with the grade ages of other high schools. And their time in America, 1 to 3 years, which is a relatively short time if you think about the process of acculturation. And their prior schooling in their respective countries, most of them did come from China. They completed the 7th through 9th grades, depending on the age of the person. When I thought about the best way to get the information that I thought was an appropriate direction, I thought about a two-step process to gather my information. I chose the interview and questionnaire strategies. The interview because I wanted to get almost a spontaneous response from these students to the questions that I had about school events, about their experience and interactions with people in the school. So I chose the interview questions. The questionnaire itself was a backup for me. So it became a backup. If I was not able to get the information from the interview questions, I was able to get it from the survey. Interestingly, of the 17 items, I was really only able to use about five because the students have not been here long enough and don't have the cultural knowledge of other schools to hypothesize what types of classes or courses they could take if they had the choice. My question to them was, if you had a choice, what other subjects would you take? And they didn't know what to say. They gave me some traditional subjects, but really, they told me mathematics, they told me, someone told me beautician school, another person told me business, which was interesting, a little bit of a variety. But on the whole, these students were not able to really go beyond the immediate curriculum that they are part of now. They didn't know what else was out there, in other words. I clearly came away with the feeling that they didn't know what other schools were doing, which tells me that they're not as informed as they should be. Now, perhaps the counselor did go over certain things with them, but if they don't have a context to interpret what the information is, some of that information might be lost on them. For example, if they don't know what some of the technical words might be that the counselor might tell them about, architecture, for example. Not that they wouldn't look it up, they would eventually. But immediately it may be lost on them. So during the interview step, I found that students were not able to really explain their dreams about being in school, where they could aspire to in 3 years. They couldn't go beyond where they are now because it seemed that they were struggling with who they are and what's to become of them. Very survival type questions. And just thinking about it gives me goosebumps. I'll tell you a very short story. During the interview process, one of the students revealed that he felt so pressured by his parents' school to achieve. And he had this enormous amount, he had this huge backpack on him, as you can imagine. And he said to me, you know, I don't know what to do. I want to stop. I don't know where to turn. He's only one person, but there are so many youngsters like him, I'm sure, who feel this way but aren't able to verbalize it. So it didn't really come out in the interview questions. I have to rethink the interview questions so that I could get at some of the specifics, some of the feelings that they have as they're going through the process, some of the desires that they have. I might have to be much more specific and let them tell me yes or no rather than have open-ended questions. I really felt for them. During this time also, during the interview time, I would often sit with the students. I'd have a group of students of about 7 or 8, and we'd sit around and talk, and we would talk about going to college. And I found that they didn't really have the confidence that they could go on to college. Yes, many of our students do go on to college, but that might be after a prolonged period of time in the system. Prolonged maybe 4 to 5 years. And that troubles me, that concerns me. Either the services at the school are not attending to those special needs, or there aren't enough counseling sessions for these students so that they could go, they could dream. And the saddest time for me, the saddest moment of realization when I did these interviews was that it's not that they couldn't dream, they didn't know what to dream about. And that's what concerns me, that they don't know what to dream about. The questionnaire itself revealed quite a bit. And from the questionnaire, I was able to develop an acculturation model, which is what you'll see in a few minutes. Okay, thank you. Okay. The method of analysis of for my research, I gathered all of the data, and what I did was I took all the possible questions that I thought really spoke to acculturation, that really spoke directly to acculturation rather than indirectly. What language do you use? May not be. What kinds of interactions do you like? That's not direct enough for me. Once I gathered a pool of questions that I thought were directly related to acculturation, I did an item analysis to reduce the number of possible questions that deal directly to acculturation. And by the end, I had 8. That became my definition of acculturation that I was able to use as a beginning first step for a model. Once the item analysis was completed and I cleaned up those questions and reduced it to 8, I needed to do a factor analysis on the other questions that I did not choose. From the factor analysis, 4 came out. The factor analysis questions fed into the first set of questions, so they were related. The first set was a definition of acculturation. The second set was the reasons why, or the contributing factors to, and there were 4, and you'll see that. So the relationship between the dependent and the independent variables is that the independent variable explains the definition called acculturation. And then the statistical modeling was exactly that, the 2 scales. They're scales that I developed, that both together, for me, are a beginning point for an acculturation model within the school. Okay, and there you go. The findings of the study, and I'll give you a moment just to look at them. Okay, this is the dependent variable, definition of acculturation. That's the independent variable, and it explains how acculturation may or may not be actualized. Hello, come on in, have a seat. If you have any questions along the way, I certainly invite you to ask any questions that you might have. I like it to be a little bit more interactive. So please don't hesitate. Yes?
I'm sorry if you already explained this, but was the sample randomly selected?
No. Yes, it was. Yes, it was. Yes. Right. Mm-hmm.
And also, mm-hmm. Do you think we could have access to the questionnaire you used to use it for other cultures as well?
I can definitely give it to you, but at this point, I think I need to refine, especially the interview questions. And I just completed the analysis over the summer, and I haven't had time to really look at the questionnaire again. I will be collecting more data in a larger setting. This is only the beginning of something for me to begin to hang on to so that I can go into the field to look at further studies. If you give me your name and address, I'll see if I can get one, a copy to you, a finalized copy. Okay? Yeah. All righty. Any other questions?
Can we get a list of this?
Sure. Mm-hmm. Okay. For me, it seems so obvious that these descriptors speak to acculturation, using English, speaking English, understanding the teacher's thinking. In other words, that's still a language piece, and that's an emotional piece, that teachers understand that student, and the student understands the teacher's thinking. Making American friends, having both types of friends, American and Chinese, succeeding in the U.S., feeling a part of the U.S., attending school activities to learn about the American culture. All of these were questions that spoke directly to acculturation, according to those students. And that's what's so important. The population drives the research. I can hypothesize, but they either prove or disprove some of my hypotheses. When I did a distillation, as it were, of the other questions that I analyzed the remaining part of the questions, these pieces came out to be important as causal factors in actualizing these. What I found interesting there was that computers took a very major position. on three levels: learning English, to develop cultural awareness, and to adjust to life in America. So I put those in at the end because I'm a technology person and I wanted to know if this had an influence or not, or did the kids think that it did? And it really did. This was the most powerful indicator of acculturation for them. Of course, the second bullet, participate in extra activities outside of Chinatown. And that echoes my first study, which is activities outside Chinatown are really important to them. They see that. The desire is there. And then this was an interesting one, and I really couldn't explain this as well. Perhaps you can give me some insight. They believe that Chinese teachers understand them. How does that help them acculturate? Anybody thought?
I was thinking that actually when I read the dependent variables, I was thinking it's interesting that there's nothing in regards to appreciating their own culture, because I see that as an immigrant myself and working with immigrants. I think when we appreciate our own culture, we feel more comfortable in
yes.
any culture.
Yes.
So
yes.
I think that's why with the Chinese teachers, there's better
yes.
rapport, there's better self, less sense of underestimation or inferiority, so you're open to mixing with the other cultures.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that was the finding of the first study that I did, that the home and the home culture and the Chinese language help them feel confident about who they are in America. That was the first study. So this echoes that. And thank you very much for confirming that. Sally?
We can also see that the Chinese person is succeeding
uh-huh.
in a specific job. And
uh-huh.
They can do the same kind of thing. They can also succeed in a particular job. They're actually seeing it right there.
Right, right. These students, again, they're here from 1 to 3 years, and this, for me, is a very critical time in their lives. They're 16, 17 years old. I mean, they should be running with their dreams. But the fact is that they can't really run because they don't have enough cultural knowledge and perhaps not enough confidence. So that perhaps, Dr. Milgram, they may succeed later on. But if they are hopeful that they see that they can succeed, I think that propels them into exploring more. The findings from the first study clearly indicate that these students wanted to explore other aspects of the American culture other than their immediate home and maybe their friends. They wanted to get out. They wanted to use credit cards, take cabs, and things like that. Uh-huh. That was my first study. This study, I didn't ask those questions, but clearly, as the young person over there, young lady, pointed out, they have a very close connection to their home culture, and therefore what teachers think or believe or understand about them is very critical to them. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then using English with American friends clearly is a language. The importance of language is so critical here and in the first set of variables, or in the dependent variable. So this for me became an acculturation model. The independent variable becomes more of the dimensions, I'd say, without or outside of the school, and this within the school. So it's I have to reconfigure it and see where the overlaps are and come up with a very clean model. There were some gaps, though, in my research. And the gaps, I feel, were that I did not get enough into the minds or the psychology of the student as that student or students as they are experiencing acculturation. And I think that's really important because these kids are so quiet. They're wonderful, but they're so quiet, and you can't get from them what they're really thinking unless you probe them. And for me, I think that's really important. Okay, thank you. The implications of the study. I feel that the burden in this case is on the school and faculty. I really truly believe this. Not because there's any judgment here, but because I think our policies, our school policies, have not been strong enough where they really promote cultural awareness beyond the surface level, or deeper levels of culture. I believe that there isn't enough of that for a lot of reasons, political, financial, or whatever. So in summary, what I did was, for the study itself, I said that looking at the data, I felt that there needed to be a concerted effort for teachers to participate in professional development about cultural sensitivity. I know that we had that a bunch of years ago, but we seem to have lost it, you know, possibly because of financial dire straits that we're in. More importantly, because I did ask students about this too, about teaching strategies in the classroom, that teachers need to adjust their approaches and strategies so that you give audience to dialoguing about the different cultures in the class, not just on food and fashion and music, but what does a teenager feel about dating, for example? What does a teenager feel about taking on the responsibilities of taking care of their siblings? So for me, teachers need to give more audience to these kinds of discussions. And I think this almost is, it's interesting. I'm a teacher, and I would imagine many of you are teachers, that sometimes our teaching and learning styles, the learning styles of our students, that is, there's a mismatch. When teachers are not aware of this, and I certainly had been a part of that, when we're not aware of this, we lose our children, we lose our youngsters in the discussion. And we can't afford to do that for these kids because they're at a very critical time in their lives. We ask that school and faculty become better sensitized to students' cultural styles, not just learning styles, but cultural styles. What is it inherent in the culture that might cause certain learning styles? So cultural styles becomes a causal factor, not the end product, learning styles. Design programs that explore cultural awareness, but on deeper levels. And certainly not last, but a very important piece, provide opportunities for students to express their feelings about acculturation. Not just to have them go to a movie and discuss that, but to discuss some of the internal conflicts that the characters exhibit, and then draw parallels to their personal lives. There needs to be that kind of dialoguing when we want our students to develop social strategies and how to negotiate the culture, the American culture. Okay, are there any questions on that? Okay, thank you. There's a responsibility on that part of students as well. They have to really try to understand who they are and how they balance their home and school identities, or this, and how they balance their culture at home, their personal culture and the American culture. So they're balancing a lot here. They have to forgive themselves for being frustrated. They have to allow themselves to be disappointed. But if there's no one that really dialogues with them that it's okay to feel frustrated, that it's okay to be disappointed, they might not be able to distill those feelings so they can articulate them. And that's really important, that they understand their cross-cultural identity. There are conflicts between the home culture and the school culture, clearly, or the main culture. And kids have to realize that they are, and that it's okay. Research says that our kids become socially adapted. They don't acculturate. They socially adapt, where they take on values that seem to fit their personal style or their cultural style. They retain those, and they take on new ones from the American culture. So they take some from the American culture, but retain some of their own. So they adapt. They don't acculturate. Acculturate means that they adjust, not completely, but they are adjusting with this long-term goal of assimilation. That no longer is the case. Acculturation clearly is multilinear. It's multidimensional. It's multifaceted. It's no longer just they come, they assimilate. There's so much that goes on in between. There's anomie, there's cultural tension. There's so much between the two final points. So what we're asking students is to find ways to increase their cultural awareness about their own culture and about the culture at large. They need to be encouraged to understand and to find ways. They need to be shown how to use their cultural knowledge to make informed decisions. For example, one of my students in the group said, you know, I don't understand what that guy said. Now, we're talking about pragmatic value of language. What is the real message behind what a young man would say to another man? I'm being very polite. There was an altercation, and one of the boys yelled something at the Chinese boy, and the Chinese boy said, "Well, I don't understand. I want to know what they're saying." Now, to us as teachers, it may seem like these are very simplistic words, but they're really words that are packed with a lot of maybe anger toward the newcomer. We assume, and so what we need to do as faculty is to step back and really observe. We're asking students to take this awareness of language and make informed decisions. Okay, so this guy said that. Okay, what can I say back to him, or should I say anything? If someone else says something to a young girl, for a young Chinese girl, can she interpret the full impact of that cultural message? I'm trying to think of an example, and I can't think of one right now. There's one by Crystal, but I can't remember what it is. Okay, the last piece that we want students to do, it's not the final piece, but we do want students to develop a set of social strategies that will help them negotiate the culture and the language. And I think that's really important. ESL classes are not enough. They learn the language, but they don't really learn how to use the language. They learn about the language, but not how to use the language. For example, Crystal, I remember, someone said something to Crystal, she didn't understand it, and she didn't know, she couldn't get the words out fast enough to say, hey, wait a minute, I need to repeat that again. She didn't take control of the conversation at that time, and she needed to, and that was really important for her. So we need to teach them these social strategies so that they understand that it's okay if you don't understand something, that you can ask about it. And next steps in my research. And I don't know when exactly, but these are some questions that are looming now in my mind based on this present research. What is the role of using computers in the acculturation process? How far and wide? Where does the internet play? And what role does the internet play? What kinds of activities beyond the school will facilitate acculturation? Those are the extra activities that students refer to. What kinds of interactions with teachers and other students are helpful in the process? Mm-hmm. I didn't get a clear enough picture from them about the kinds of interactions they feel are helpful. I did come away with a very clear understanding that when it came to getting academic information about their futures in college, the person did not have to be Chinese or American. They had to give the right information. So maybe it's not a function of ethnicity. Something to think about, the way that we structure our schools. And the last, again, not the last, not, certainly not the last, but on this list for the moment, what feelings, attitude, and attitudes are students experiencing during the adjustment process? For example, I'll give you a very poignant example. During the interview process, one of the students revealed that he felt very much ill at ease because in a given class, an ESL class, if he were to raise his hand and give an answer in English, he has been he's been bothered by other students who don't speak English that well, bullied in that they said remarks to him, it kind of, why are you being a show-off or something like that. So that's very perplexing for someone who tries to achieve but yet can't be. He's caught between the two cultures. And the other kids are really not kind, and for all the reasons you can surmise why they made that remark. So this is acculturation is a long process for any individual. It happens, social change takes place on an individual and psychological level, and also in society itself. Acculturation is not just linear, it's multilinear, where other students in the school would change, students perhaps who are not Chinese. Students themselves, the Chinese students, change. The faculty changes. The newcomer changes the environment, whether we realize it or not, whether they realize it. Even more importantly, do they realize what an impact they have on life in America? And the last question I have for you is, what is the experience of the Chinese American immigrant student in America? Thank you. Are there any questions? Sorry.
Was your research based on the public?
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Was your research based on public schools?
Yes.
In New York?
Yes.
And what do you think about bilingual education? Do you think it's helpful? You just mentioned basically if the student gave an answer like in English to other people. So it's mostly what? It's mostly Chinese students?
These were only Chinese students.
So is it like a school just strictly for, is it because it's based in Chinatown, that's why?
Well, I can't reveal where the school was.
No,
right.
Now,
I understand that. These are Chinese students. Your question to me is, what do I think about bilingual education?
Right.
I think there's merit to bilingual education.
Like what?
I think a type of bilingual education that is an enrichment program is called dual language programs, where it's not only the Chinese student or the Hispanic student or the French-speaking student who is responsible for learning the language, it's the rest of the school or the rest of the grade that is also responsible, so that there's a community of learners that grows with learning the culture and language of the newcomer, and of course the flip side is that the newcomer learns the American culture. So I do believe in bilingual education, but more in the dual language program format.
You mentioned the student were like on 8th, 9th, 10th grade?
No, 9th and 10th.
9th and 10th.
Yeah, this is high school, comprehensive high school.
Okay, so basically the time, I think in 10th grade they're supposed to be able to speak English. Are they, how does it work? Or are those the people who came like from mainland China or Hong Kong and basically just kind of like, how does it work?
Well, that's a very, very complex question. In a nutshell, I can say that exposure to the language and commitment by the student, it will propel them into learning it more. The more they're motivated, the better they will learn the language. Mm-hmm. And what motivates students to learn the language is an open book. We don't know. Every student is truly a special student and different. Mm-hmm. So different combinations of motivational factors will propel them into learning the language or not. Because some students stop learning. There is something that I discovered that I called in my first study the Chinatown factor, which is what I think a mediating factor in students becoming fully adapted to America. Because they're in that environment called Chinatown, it doesn't give them the exposure that I refer to. So I can appreciate your question, but it's very, very complicated.
Mm-hmm. From your experience, parents, Chinese parents, what can we do to help them integrate better in the system, navigate the system better, so to help the children do better? I know it's also very, very complex, and there's many researches about it, but
right.
I don't know if you've given
Well, I have, and I think it, I have a colleague here, Gofrey Rivera, who does parent training, and maybe he can share some of his ideas. But I will say that in a nutshell, if I can, and then ask Gofrey if he wants to add something, that I think parents have to be involved. I think that means parents need to be involved in their children's education. How you get them involved and if they are able to be involved is another issue, because many of our Chinese parents are working and they work many hours. It might mean that you have to change the way your outreach is, perhaps more phone calls by a Chinese-speaking person. maybe as visits, not in a social worker way, but take a cohort of Chinese students and visit their parents, perhaps, on the job, if need be. So it really takes reorganizing or restructuring some of the services that we have available. Mr. Rivera, do you have something to add?
Yeah, I'm Dr. Rivera, and as Virginia said, I work with a parent advocacy organization. And right now we're doing outreach projects to reach members of the community. I work mostly with Hispanic-speaking parents, but some of the issues are very, very similar. I mean, they're almost like mirror images of what Professor Tong brought up, but are addressing the issue of how to get parents involved with the children's education. It's really important, but many of the parents that are here do not know much English, mm-hmm. so that right away puts up a barrier. And on the other side, the school culture is not familiar with their culture. And this goes way beyond learning English language structures and all that, because you need to be aware of something about the history and culture of the group that you're working with. I'm doing now some research on the culture of disability and how that's impacted the cultures of the individuals. And an example would be if a practitioner, health practitioner is working with a group or a family that's new to this culture, you know, they need to know something about their folklore, their myths, their stories, their experiences in order to have a meaningful impact upon their relationship, to make us a real meaningful connection. Once that's established, the parent is less defensive, they'll feel more welcome, and they're more than willing to participate in their child's education. But as long as you have these barriers, which are on both sides actually, you know, because they need to learn language and culture of the mainstream, and the school system needs to become more aware of and understanding of their culture and language behaviors to create that bridge, there'll be an exchange that's more meaningful. So I made some notes here. It's incredible about some of the connection. I just want to ask a question while I'm here.
Okay, can I add something to what you're saying?
Okay, sure.
Yeah, I think the whole thrust of research has always has been, let's look at the product. Is the product successful or not? Without paying as much or equal as much attention to the process. And I think our world view now has become much more humanistic. And so hence the research looks back at what's happening inside the child or the parent, right, so that you can connect. It's always finding that connection. So so now what we really need to look at is process, because we've looked at product. So let's look at process now.
Yeah, just to back that up a little bit, one more example. In special education, which I've been involved with, we have adapted a clinical model of what causes it, like etiologies, you know, what causes a disease or a certain disability. And we figure that's the best answer there exists. And we do not listen to what parents say. Parents will hear our explanation about what causes cerebral palsy, but from their upbringing, they have stories from their grandmothers about, mm-hmm. you know, maybe there was some kind of a spiritual intervention involved. there was some kind of, you know, there's a lot of cultures out there.
Yes, yes. And you have to give respect.
You need to hear them and respect them, because right. if they sense that yeah. you are marginalizing them, it's over. That's the end of whatever relationship you have. So teachers, administrators, practitioners need to listen to their side of it, to their interpretation, and then add your interpretation, put that together. Then you have the basis of a relationship that will be more effective and meaningful.
I think the key word there is relationship, mm-hmm. clearly. Mm-hmm. Yes, sorry.
I have a question about, from your research, can you extrapolate any of these issues or the struggles to students who, for example, graduate students? I'm thinking that a lot of the issues that these students are dealing with, it's a very complex bag that they're carrying around.
True,
part of it
true.
May also be just the natural process of growing up.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's that only compounds it.
Trying
absolutely.
To figure out their worldview, their
right.
sexuality, everything. Right.
right?
And so I wonder if you could extrapolate from your research how some of these acculturation issues may how they're dealt with older students, graduate students particularly, students who, well, hopefully are a little bit more mature, and perhaps are coming to this country and going into programs where they have to really socially adapt very quickly. Very quickly.
Yeah.
And they don't have
it's an interesting
of the,
question.
And they don't have some of the other issues that, for example, ninth and tenth graders would have to deal with. Perhaps the issues of the home life and parent may still be there, but they're already adults, and so they're out there dealing with other issues of their lives. But they hopefully, again, they're at an age where they are dealing with life on a much more mature level.
Yeah,
they still have some of these same issues.
Yeah, I think that there's some of the cultural tensions or cultural conflicts that are inherent in the younger group are also in the older group, because it takes so long to distill those values, those conflicts. I think the difference between the younger group high school versus the graduate student, here you're talking about already completed 4 years of college at the level and then going on for graduate studies, I think there's what we call an identity problem. Not a problem. Their identity in society. For the younger kids, it's their identity within the school and with home and maybe immediately with their work. But for the older student, the graduate student, I think it's an identity like I'm accomplished. The student might feel I'm accomplished or I'm not accomplished based on the amount of integration that I have with the host society. So I think it's a matter of self-fulfillment. Those issues become larger because they are evaluated not only by their family, but by their workers or by people they work with, possibly other institutions that they might be a part of, organizations that they might be a part of. So their identity is validated by people beyond the high school or the younger set. Granted, so I think the problems are, the core issues are still the same, cultural identity. But I think they're larger in that there's a responsibility level, which perhaps some of these graduate students are also married. So they still have home, but they have responsibility issues to pay for supplies for their family and the rent and car payments and all those things that we pay. So I think it's compounded and probably exponentially becomes greater, the intensity becomes greater. When you talk about really stamping your identity and what it is, the younger people don't have that problem yet. They're still struggling. Can I even get into college? Am I going to graduate from high school? Where am I going to go after my senior year?
So in some ways you're saying the stakes are higher.
I think the stakes are higher in that way because they're really out there. They're concept of self is evaluated by many other factors, not only themselves, but the younger person, maybe it's more themselves in the immediate environment. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Mm-hmm. Take someone in the back. Hello.
I was just wondering if you have or will be making any recommendations to the school and if they're really like receptive to any kind of changes.
Yeah, those are two questions. The answer to the first one is really easy, yes. The second one, I don't know. I probably will dialogue with some of the school faculty, school personnel, about my findings. It's a research unit that approved my research, my being able to get into the schools. They asked me to give them a copy of my findings, which I will. And the fact that I'm not in the public school system, I can say what I want. And I clearly feel that there's got to be an update on teaching approaches and strategies for these students, because there's such a big gap. The needs have changed so quickly. Well, they haven't changed. They've always been there. So the answer is yes, I will share my research, and the other part is I hope that they will do something about it. Yeah, I think the more people talk about it, this hasn't been done for Asians at this age. It has been done for other groups, perhaps. I don't know if you know of other studies. For high school students aren't always studied. They aren't. It's usually college people who are studied, and elementary school or junior high, but not high school. And these are the kids that are about to make their lives. These are life decisions that they're going to make. Because are they going on to college? You know, they're still at that point. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm sorry. Can I take her first and then? Okay, I'll just.
I was wondering if you know of researches that have been done in regards to high school graduates. That is, we know we have good statistics now for Spanish speaking colleges, but I haven't heard yet as of the Chinese what's the percentage of high school graduates in the New York system, college system, and the number of those coming to go to college.
Right. The graduation rate for Chinese seems very high from what I know. Generally, Asians do well in education. But you see, it's not do they graduate and go on to college and then graduate school. We're talking about living up to their full potential. Can they really get into fields that they would not traditionally have thought about? We're talking about quality of acculturation. Not just do they
make it
right. Mm-hmm. I want more than that. That's been done. We're tired of that. We want to go on to quality stuff. Okay? That's where my thinking is.
It's sort of related is the question around their awareness of college and opportunities maybe. And it sounds like what you're saying is they, generally speaking, these students didn't have too much sense of greater opportunities out there. But do you have a sense of, from the parents and the teachers and counselors, sort of these other influences in their lives, to what extent college is being put on the table as a good option, an accessible option, or are they being treated by the school or other, you know, or by their own parents as they're not going to make it, or is it assumed? You know, what's kind of the perception?
Uh-huh. And Dr. Tam, if you want to jump in, I know that this is his area of expertise also. Just to give you my perspective on it, I know my parents have always pushed me to go to school, and many Asian parents, Chinese parents, I can only speak for Chinese parents, of course, that's my experience, they push for the education agenda. They push for us to achieve and not to slack off. I think these kids are, I think that the parents of these kids probably do say move ahead, but these kids are struggling with, well, who am I in America? Can I really make it into college? Can I think that I can make it into college? Yeah, my parents tell me so. Perhaps their parents may or may not have college education. They still push their students, they still push their children, but do the students really have the hope that they can achieve it? And that, for me, I think there's a gap there. Now, I only went to one school, and that's why I want to look at other schools. I wonder how, and this is strictly my personal opinion, my personal reflection, I wonder how many school faculty and school administrations really go out of their way to be available, to be accessible, to give the kind of counseling that's very special to these students. I wonder, and it would be an interesting survey to look at what they do out in the field. That's just a question I have. Do they really give them the time, or are they slighting the students the time? I will tell you what came out in the interviews is that the counselors were not available to them. There were too few counselors. And that's not necessarily the fault of the counselors when you're talking about thousands of students in a school. It's a system. But the system forgets that this is a very important part of the personal growth of an individual. So you're talking about family values, and I want to throw it back to Dr. Tam. Do you want to add something, Dr. Tam?
I just want to add, and that is, I think in terms of, say, the expectations of the performance of the students, for example, you know, whether or not, say, in some Chinese families, you know, what kind of expectations and how that determines their performance, etc. It happened quite often, for example, that for female children, the expectation is much less than for male, for example, and that certainly would affect their performance.
Mm. It's true.
But I think that one of the problems, and we have, I'm sorry that we didn't invite you to that the student colloquium. We had held a colloquium on Asian American students. And
oh, yeah.
One of the things that people talked about was that, you know, it's just that there's a model minority myth about Asian students, and including the Chinese students. And they always think that they are doing so well, they're in all these good schools, they're smart and everything, and they forget that there's another side to it.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that they are really poor students who are ill-equipped in terms of language, in terms of the quantitative thinking, etc., but in terms of adaptation to the American culture, the kind of problems that they have personally, you know, sexuality, you know, their own identity, all of these issues are not expressed. It's totally discouraged at home. And if they don't find a way of expressing themselves, then it's really troublesome. There are ways, you know, for example, you know, I'm very concerned about you know, the suicidal problems that link with that, the depression and that sort of thing. You know, the headlines that you read sometimes about Asian suicide, especially female, young female students, for example. And these are major problems, but we were thinking that, well, if there are ways of, say, finding out more about what their thinkings are and how they can be reached, between the community, the family, the school, maybe something can be done about.
I agree with you, Dr. Tam. I think reaching them is so critical. There's also, I think, another gap. There's that academic achievement piece, but there's also to help them feel confident that they can be leaders within their own lives and leaders in eventual companies that they might work in. They need to have this kind of encouragement. And I think that leadership development skills is something that is glossed over and not looked at for these kids because of all the reasons that Dr. Tam talked about, that they're model minorities. Well, they're not model minorities. A lot of these kids, this is only a small population, these kids don't come with the best education. They're out in the education is in the, and here you have to help me, out in the villages perhaps, or maybe there are none, very few in the villages, but more in the internal part of the city. So their exposure to education, the cognitive and critical analytical thinking skills, are not as well developed. That's something that's really important too.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to just add a couple of comments to what you're talking
Please
about.
Please do,
because,
yes.
Because I think the whole, the aspect of the myth of the model minority contributes to the way the administration of the school system deals with the Asian American kids,
right,
that they'll be okay and they're headed for college, because I think there's that other aspect of, I know in my personal life, that there, I know people who, and myself included, that we were pushed to achieve academically, but at the end of high school it was get a job.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. College isn't going to do anything for you to get a job, because our immediate concern is whatever the financial situation
right.
found.
Right.
What's at the time? Yeah. The other thing too, in terms of leadership, I think there's an aspect of how the majority culture looks at leadership.
Mm-hmm.
That very often it's the one who raises the hand, who talks a lot, who creates the kind of attention that many teachers and other educators will look at as, oh, this person is a leader.
Right.
Whereas the whole idea of leadership for, I think, a lot of cultures is taken totally different, and it's looked at differently.
Uh-huh.
And I, just using my personal experience as well, my son, who is 13 now, was always not looked at as a leader, but you know, he certainly was one. It just
mm-hmm.
was not the kind of person who would raise his hand.
Right.
And shout out the answer or try to make himself known.
Right.
But among his friends and among his peers, he was certainly looked at, up to as a leader, as somebody to model after.
Right, because he made decisions.
He made decisions,
right.
But it wasn't always
wasn't always out there, yeah. Right? And you know, that's an interesting point that you bring up, that there are different leadership styles.
Exactly.
That a part of the American culture is that they see people who are outspoken and who raise their hands or who make the most noise sometimes, that they're the leaders, but actually if you look at their words, their words may not be as constructive as someone who has a good idea. And our Chinese kids, our Asian kids are just so quiet. And it invites a lot of misconceptions and misunderstandings, yeah, truly. Mm-hmm. Mr. Rivera?
Yes, as things turn out, most of the students that you work with, actually a lot of students have more access to computers than they do to counselors and other school personnel. And one of the things that you mentioned in things that you might want to explore is what role computers may have in the acculturation process. Do you have ideas about where that may go?
Well, I actually do. I think first you have to expose students to the information or how to get the information, and many of them already know how to use computers. They could probably teach me a few things. It's what they do with that information is that what we have to help them begin to focus on. How can they productively search out answers to the questions that they might have about a particular occupation, for example, about what other campuses are doing or what other high schools are doing, so that a teacher might give an assignment for them to go on the internet, look at a school in California, a comparable school, and look at the kinds of programs that are there. Or maybe even just look within our New York City Department of Education to see what kind of programs we have here, so that computers in that way to gain information, and of course you can do all kinds of research projects, electronic research projects and things like that, and use email. That's almost a given. But I see the computer as a way to help them bring in information, as you all experience this. Computers also allow them to take responsibility for their own learning. And I think that for some of our students, they're still new at student-centered learning, that they're still looking for the teacher to talk to them. I'm a great supporter of group work, and Ruby is one of my students, and I'm sure you'll attest to that, right, Ruby? I'm a great supporter of group work and students constructing knowledge together. And when students get used to that kind of thinking, I think the computer room will allow them to work together at a station. So I see the computer used in various ways to access information, to cultivate social interaction, and to construct knowledge that they take responsibly and develop some of the critical and analytical skills. So it's a cognitive aspect. So there's a cognitive, a social, and cultural aspect. Mm-hmm. Other questions? Any other questions?
I'm just wondering, in terms of acculturation, because sometimes we say that this person is more acculturated than the other and stuff like that. And I think that in your presentation, you pointed out many different elements of acculturation. Now, how can one sort of have some sort of index and say, well, this person is, say, 2 degrees more acculturated than the other.
Right. That's why I'm trying to develop a model so that I can begin to develop a scale. If they participate in these three activities, they might be more acculturated than someone else. It's not only just the number of activities, but the types of activities. So once I begin to, I look at the both scales and see which ones they participate in, I might get a better sense. In the literature, there is a model of acculturation, and in the middle of it is called social adaptation. This model does not help me as much. I'm interested in what specifics are for each of those phases. So what I need to do is take this information and begin to kind of prioritize what I think might be activities that might be close, what we call proximity or distance. They're closer to the culture, or they're more distant from the culture. So thank you. You've given me some food for thought, Dr. Tam. I very much appreciate that. Any other questions? Thank you very much. I'll write that down. Yes?
To those students that
that did not make it to go to college.
Uh-huh.
What avenues available for them?
What avenues?
In terms of skill training. So.
Well, it depends. Well, first of all, I don't know what the background is of the student that you're thinking about. The one who doesn't go to college, or maybe who can't make it into college, may mean that they're not prepared, that they are underprepared and can't handle the academic work, at least at this point in time.
Yes.
But perhaps they could be non-matriculated and catch up. You know, it's interesting that you asked that question, because during the interview process, they didn't feel that they were adequate enough to go on to college. And when I talk to them about going on to a two-year college and then transferring later on, they go, wow, you mean we can do that? Or just take courses as a non-matric. Oh, we can do that? Yes, you can do that. I mean, it's not the best way, I'm sure. It's not the best way to get into college, but it's another way of getting into college. So in terms, you asked me about training, though. Training, it depends. They may, and I'm thinking about the men, because our society, quite frankly, it's very male, female oriented in that way, traditionally speaking, that the men would go out and go to more schooling and the woman might stay back, in a more traditional sense I'm talking about, stay back and take care of the kids and maybe not go on for other trainings. There are some training programs, like in Chinatown Manpower Project, which teaches secretarial and administrative skills. And medical skills, nursing skills, and such. And there, the students don't have to have a high school diploma. Actually, you know, certain programs within Chinatown Manpower Project, they only have to have an eighth grade education. So let's say they come here and they go to high school for 1 or 2 years, don't finish it, they can go into those community-based organization programs. CPC, Chinatown Planning Council, might have some programs, although I don't know them as well. I know Chinatown Manpower Project very well. So they had cooking classes, they had secretarial classes, administrative assistant computer classes available to those students. And of course, then there's always that two-year college that they can go to and then go on. And then some of them go on to trade schools like, I don't even know if this is still around anymore, you can tell me, RCA or these technology, what's the name of the new one? There's a new one out there. Do you know, Anthony? There is a trade school that teaches, schools like that. And these kids will get by. But it'll be hard because the content in those textbooks can be very technical. So you need teachers who know how to teach content-based instruction so that they get the content, so that they can do their jobs well and then move on to managerial jobs. But I would guess that you only need a high school diploma. But if you're talking about kids who don't have a high school diploma, I'd say probably more community-based organization type programs versus an established trade school type program. Well, maybe not, maybe not. What happens to some of the students when they go to school, they become inspired and they'll do perhaps, and I don't have any stats on it, but perhaps they'll become inspired and go on for more traditional kinds of programs where they'll get their GED. Although, if you can imagine what a GED is like, or just going through high school, all that English is very hard for a student who comes here at an older age. They're embarrassed. You know, they're already on the brink of who are they in the society versus a child who is still finding their identity. Mm-hmm. So it's very complex. You have to look at it. But I think there are some solutions to those students' situations. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. My pleasure. My absolute pleasure. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, sorry. I was going to walk out with this.
Thank you very much.